My dear friends, on the behalf of the World Tourism Organization, the UNWTO, it's a great, great pleasure for me to address you on the occasion of the Tourism Expo in Japan. We're particularly happy to support the Tourism Expo's first ever Ministerial Round Table. I personally would have loved to be there for this occasion, but prior commitments and personal matters didn't allow me. It's the first time I missed this beautiful event, and I truly, truly feel sad about it. My dear friends, this comes at a very important time for travel and tourism sector. Your meeting comes at a very timely occasion. As we mark 2017 as the International Year of Sustainable Tourism for Development and Peace, this year is a unique opportunity for all of us to come together to promote the contribution of this wonderful industry called travel and tourism as a universal and human activity of the 21st century to contribute to building a better world for a better people and a better planet. My dear friends, we truly live today in the age of travel. International tourism arrivals rose from just 25 million in 1950 to 1,235 billion in 2016. And the center of gravity of this era of tourism and travel is fast shifting east towards Asia, particularly Japan, that is playing a huge part in the region's tourism success, both as a destination and as a source market. As a destination, so many travelers are coming to Japan every year because they know they feel good in Japan. They know they'll be very welcomed in Japan. Japan is a very special country. We feel respect to the people, to the culture, to the history, to the environment. Everything that's in Japan is about you feeling good. I'm sure that Japan can continue to be a world leader in tourism for inclusive and sustainable development as well. My dear friends, today's roundtable is about the opportunities of discussions on how to really maximize tourism's contribution to our agenda for 2030, the global agenda, as outlined by the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals. Tourism is specifically mentioned in three of these SDGs, Goal 8, Goal 12, and Goal 14. Yet, with its global reach and wide impact, tourism can contribute to all 17 development goals. As we celebrate the International Year of Sustainable Tourism Development, this is a very important goal. Let us all reaffirm our commitment to sustainability, to the goal and the roadmap of 2030, to our core business in life, which is to make this world a better place. I wish you an excellent roundtable, and I'm looking forward to hear about the conclusions. And I promise you to always be connected to you. I thank you all very much. Thank you.
Excellent. Ladies and gentlemen, with that scene setter from Dr. Rifai, we're now going to get into the actual conversations themselves. What is so important about 2017 is that it's not actually about 2017. We need to make sure that sustainable tourism for development lives on long past 2017. This is our year to share, to exchange, to get understanding. And for that purpose, we have an exceptional panel of speakers who are going to be giving us a sense of, in their context, in their countries, in their organization, not just what are the policies that are in place around sustainable development, what are the principles and what are the practices? How can we learn from one another to make sure that our industry truly unites long beyond 2017? Now, each of our speakers has been given 3 minutes. They each have 3 minutes to give their point of view, and they've all been lovingly warned that as soon as we go 1 second past 3 minutes, I'm going to start closing in on you. And you will know that 10 seconds in, I'm going to close your microphone. But with that, again, we want to squeeze the most out so that we can gain their incredible wisdom and insight, but also have a conversation afterwards. To start off, sir, I'm going to challenge you first to begin. May I please ask Mr. Akihiko Tamura, the Commissioner of Japan Tourism Agency, to please share. We welcome you.
Good morning, Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Japan and welcome to our Tourism Expo Japan. Well, today I provided a draft in Japanese, and I heard that very are capable or simultaneous interpreters that are standing by, so I let them work, and Channel 2 will provide the English.
So, ladies and gentlemen, this Ministerial Round Table of Tourism Expo Japan being held in such a grand manner, I'd like to congratulate on this occasion what each country is doing. It's going to be exchanged. This is a valuable opportunity for us to exchange. And this will be very useful for us to design future tourism policies. Tourism involves exchanges of human beings, thus enrich the livelihood of people in terms of economy as well. Relevant industries will be vitalized through tourism. On the other hand, protecting environment and nature and retaining traditions, we have to have sustainable development for development. The local citizens and tourists both need to enjoy this opportunity. This must be win-win relationship so that the tourism itself will be sustainable as we try to provide tourist services. There will be increasing demand for tourism on a global scale. So global sustainability in tourism is called upon. In 2015, UNWTO issued a resolution on International Year of Sustainable Tourism for Development. We would like to take this as an opportunity so that Japan can further cooperate with UNWTO to organize international conferences in different local communities so that we can share best practices on sustainable tourism. As one of the Executive Council members of UNWTO, we would like to do the best possible promotion for better understanding of sustainable tourism. Japan included tourism as a major part of its growth strategy because we believe it is attributable to revitalization of local economy. It's not just quantity. It is important to see improvement in quality as well. There are five important areas which were already introduced. We have to ensure sustainability, paying attention to those five important areas as we develop tourism. Already, some local communities are feeling stressed due to excessive number of tourists visiting the community. So once again, we have to return back to sustainability of tourism. We are promoting not only inbound travel, but also domestic and outbound tourism so that we would like to produce and promote interactive tourist exchanges. Again, our intention is to continue to work with all the other countries for sustainable tourism. Thank you.
Gato.
Thank you very much.
Colleagues from Japan that are going to be opening up this initial session is that, as per usual with the beautiful Japanese, you were exactly 3 minutes. So I thank you very much, and everyone else's challenge to stick to that. May I please ask to take on the three-minute challenge, Mr. Tetsuro Tomita, the chair of the Tourism Committee of the Japan Business Foundation. Sir.
Thank you very much for the introduction. I am the president and CEO of East Japan Railway Company, JR East. I would like to speak in Japanese.
Receiver.
And I would like to be seated as I present my 3 minutes. First of all, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Japan. And I work in a railway company. I serve as the president and CEO of East Japan Railway Company. And during your stay in Japan, I hope that you will experience the railway system in Japan to experience the comfort and the safety of the train system in Japan. And as was just mentioned by Mr. Tamura, actually working with Mr. Tamura's agency, we are actually promoting tourism industry as a growth industry as we expect an aging society, and hopefully we can make this into a very core industry going forward, and we're making our utmost effort. And as a train system operator, such a private-public sector collaboration is very important. In that framework, we're doing our utmost. Now, there are several examples of our activities at the railway company I'd like to share with you. Some JR, Japan Railways, there are group companies or JR companies, or and destination campaign has been conducted since over 10 years ago, and we're collaborating with the destination communities to really identify some of the hidden sources of tourism so that it can be presentable to the rest of the world, so that there can be additional or new exchanges receiving tourists from around the world, so that we can generate more jobs for the people. Therefore, for the past four decades, for specific prefectures around Japan, we have been conducting this destination campaign. And after the earthquake in 2011, for six consecutive years, we have been focusing on the Tohoku region that were the most hit as the destination, which is the primary focus of the campaign for the past 6 years, so that we can contribute to the reconstruction effort after the earthquake, and we have been successful in doing that. So that's case number one. And my second case is focusing on local produce of the different parts of Japan, brought over and sold in major markets in Tokyo and others, whether it is fishery, seafood, or dairy products, or other agricultural products. By marketing them in the large cities, we think we can create or generate this exchange of people and goods. And so through such activities, the people living in large cities hopefully can come across the cultures, the traditions, the entertainment, the local industries. They would find them for the first time, and then that would motivate them to travel to those different parts of Japan. And so through such activities, our a railway company has been not just providing railway transportation service, but we have been a part of this contribution to revitalize the different localities. And part of that is generating or creating new jobs as well. And we believe that this is a very important aspect, and that is exactly what we're trying to achieve. And through such activities, as Dr. Rifai of UNWTO mentioned in his message, it's important that we provide hospitality and provide comfort that people around the world find pleasing. And we really hope to continue with that impression that people have about the Japanese. And working together with you, we would like to maximize the potential of tourism so that sustainable tourism for development can be nurtured and further developed in Japan. So we ask for your continued support going forward. Thank you very much.
Arigato, sir. Perfect, perfect timing. If a rail man can't do it in 3 minutes exact in Japan, no one can. I'm going to take someone out of their misery, because a dear colleague of mine is now starting to get very nervous, knowing I've got 180 seconds and she is going to cut me off if I hit 181. So, our dear friend, Mr. Sujing, from your perspective, please.
The Secretary General of UNWTO, as you all know, is one of the best speakers in our circle. So I wonder, after his message in video, how I can be even to this very impossible mission. At one stage, I almost tempted to speak probably in Japanese in order to make the difference. Anita, thank you for giving me the floor. And since this is my first time taking the floor, I thought it is extremely important to express how happy I am to be back in Japan. The world is now zooming into the focus of Japan, and I wanted to thank the organizers of the Tourism Expo Japan, the JATA, the JTTA, the JNTO, as well as JTA, for inviting once again the representative of UNWTO to be part of this very happy celebration. Indeed, it is time for us to celebrate. You heard earlier from the Honorable Minister of Japan that our industry has the reason to take the pride, because you heard about the global figure of roughly 4% growth rate for last year. And that means every single day we have roughly 3 to 4 million international tourists crossing national borders to travel around the world. And that explains why we are able to generate 1 out of every 10 jobs that is created in this world. It attributes to the travel and tourism industry. And we have every reason to celebrate this. But ladies and gentlemen, what is more important, and this is probably my second message to you, is that finally, this year, we've been able to catch the attention not only of the tourism industry, but the attention of the international community at large. And that explains why the entire United Nations system is celebrating the International Year of Sustainable Tourism for Development. That explains why 3 goals out of the UN Sustainable Development Goals are extremely directly linked with that of tourism. You heard from my Secretary General. So this explains why we need to celebrate ourselves, that we finally no longer talking only to the converted. We are talking and we are catching the attention of the civil society at large and the whole international community. And I think today, if we come to the topic of the Ministerial Round Table, you heard from Anita that growth of tourism must be sustainable. This is where we must make ourselves relevant to the society, to the social and economic development. That growth not only must be sustainable, but must be also socially inclusive. And it must be also linked with our cultural values, with our heritage, and most importantly, with the mutual understanding of peoples and linking with the good cause of peace. And probably, I hope I'm not running short of time, that we need to take a balanced approach. And that balanced approach explains from the video that you already watched at the very beginning of this round table, and that is not only you want to travel, not only you want to enjoy, but most importantly, you want to respect the people, respect the world, and respect yourself. I thank you.
Arigato. Thank you, Su Jing. And I must admit, a little secret to share with you all. One of the reasons why Su Jing was so excited to come to Japan, in addition to the fact that he absolutely loves being in Japan, is because he has just left Chengdu, as many of you know. Because the UNWTO had their General Assembly, and as Dr. Rifai promised, it was the best General Assembly they've ever had. The chief engineer behind the scenes of the General Assembly was this beautiful man who worked tirelessly. And what's lovely is that his coming here, he knew that he didn't have to organize anything. But But I do believe, though, that when he looks out across the hotel, he looks out across the audience. For what he has been focused on for the last 2 years, he's still thinking, but where are the pandas? There's supposed to be pandas out here. So we thank you for being here, for coming back with your energy and giving us your perspective. Another gentleman who joins us around the world and is a true leader of tourism as a force for good, from the private sector side, a critical partner in sustainable tourism for development and in global development, is our next speaker, the dear Mr. Gerald Lawless.
Thank you very much. I thought I'd be going at about number 17 or something on this particular round table.
Sorry, I thought I'd be going at about number 17 in this particular round table. And I know that as an Irishman, we're not famous for stopping talking after 3 minutes, but I will certainly do my best. As representing the World Travel and Tourism Council, I'm particularly honoured to be here today, to have the opportunity to speak to this esteemed audience and to talk just a little bit for a couple of minutes about the value of travel and tourism and what we within the private sector, what we do and what we believe in as far as travel and tourism is concerned. And I think what a fitting tribute it is to our great friend Dr. Taleb Rifai that this year should be the year of sustainable tourism for development. I think it's something that he has worked so hard to achieve and has really brought this to the fore for the future. I find when we go to these events, we always end up, as you said earlier, Sujeng, speaking to the converted. We all congratulate ourselves on the benefits of tourism and how great tourism is for society, and yes, we believe in that. But I know that we also have to address what we will all be talking about over the next 3 to 4 days, is how do we cope with our own success, with the fact that 1.2 billion people worldwide are now taking journeys every year, international journeys. And yes, we hope it will grow. And it will grow for the benefit of society, for the benefit of global GDP, and what we can do for people to take them out of poverty, to give them the opportunity to stay in their home communities, to work in small hotels, restaurants, and indeed in everything associated with travel and tourism. But how do we cope with the areas such as Venice, for example, where I read a statistic where in 1950, 155,000 people lived in the city of Venice, local people living there. Today, 50,000 people live in the city of Venice because they've been driven out, they say, by high prices. We've seen the situation in Barcelona not so many weeks ago, before the terrible atrocity of terrorism, where a tourism bus was actually attacked and was daubed with paint and with graffiti because people say, we don't want so much tourism. The mayor of Barcelona says that in his election campaign that he actually wants to reduce tourism to Barcelona. And yes, we all look at it and we say, and I'm a hotelier by background, and I know that as demand goes up, our rates go up. We see it in yield management, we see it in the airlines, we see it everywhere. So therefore, we know that to a certain extent, that tourism will be managed and will be controlled very much due to pricing. But where does that leave all the lovely people who want to travel, who want to experience the rest of the world? And again, just going back to my home country, Ireland, we have seen where Dublin, for example, is very heavily visited at the moment. But the Tourism Ireland introduced a very interesting concept where on the western seaboard of the island of Ireland, if you can imagine it, there's nothing between us and New York. Actually, we say New York is a small village off the coast of Ireland. But we obviously know differently. But they brought in what they called the Wild Atlantic Way, which is a 2,000 kilometer drive from the north of the country right to the south of the country. And this has cycle tracks, it has small bed and breakfasts, it has small hotels, it has large hotels, but it is an opportunity for people to see more of the country than just the capital city or just the most famous city. And I think that is very important as we try to manage our tourism product on an international basis. Our other big aspect of tourism is a great driver of peace. Last year I went to visit the First Minister of Northern Ireland, who was saying that that peace drives tourism. And I said, no, I think tourism drives peace. It brings us together, it gets us to respect each other, it gets us to know each other. And I've seen this in the city where I live, in Dubai, where His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum, the ruler of Dubai, founded the Sheikh Mohammed Center for Cultural Understanding, where every week us hoteliers are invited to take our guests to a local mosque, where these are non-Muslims who receive a lecture from an imam in the mosque. And the imam talks not about the differences of our religions, but actually about the similarities of so many religions, particularly in this case, talking about Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. And our guests come out with actually a sense of enrichment, a sense of doing something good on their holiday. Of course, they need to relax and enjoy themselves, but at the same time, they also seem what need to connect with the local community and try to understand it. And this, of course, is very much what we would always say are the benefits for tourism, showing that tourism is indeed a force for good, and we can congratulate ourselves as being part of this. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Excellent. Thank you, Mr. Lawless. I must say, as many of you saw watching the clock itself, Mr. Lawless was given extra time for two reasons. Firstly, he provided the superb example of, if we are going to work together for sustainable tourism, we need to be honest, not just of the opportunities, but of the challenges that exist. Because otherwise, we are actually creating a blind spot, quite hypocritically, in a way that is not going to help us in the long run. Secondly, there is no one like the Irish to be able to deliver a sharp message with the most beautiful lyrical accent so we can get away with it. But again, I think the important thing is that as someone who is absolutely a hotelier at heart, he's a businessman who knows what the metrics are, and we need to manage those metrics. And so we want to carry out the rest of the conversation really focusing on how can we share the problems to find solutions, not just share the celebrations. Which brings me to my next speaker, who is the lovely chairperson of PATA, an incredible friend of this region and the world when it comes not just to knowledge and insight, but cooperation and helping us all work together. Ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Sarah Matthews.
Ohayou gozaimasu. I don't speak Japanese. I can only say squashy. If only I could speak better Japanese, so I apologize. I was telling Gerald that my ancestors come from Ireland, so potentially I get more than 3 minutes. I actually want to speak very quickly because what I'd like to do is yield the time to having a really productive discussion on tangible results that we can take out to businesses. PATA, as many of you know, is a not-for-profit organization based in Asia. Our members are across the Asia Pacific and in fact across the world. There are many core topics that PATA is very focused on, but one of the big issues that we're very focused on is dispersal of travel. So many of us travel to cities, London, Osaka, and what we really want is to discover other places. And that's really important in helping the small business owners get into the game, getting them support in developing their businesses, and most importantly, talking about their stories. Because their stories are what makes up your destination. And so I think that's a really core focus of the Pacific Asia Traveler Association, supporting businesses across Asia Pacific, working with government. I'm going to steal Khun Kop Khan, the minister's fabulous idea. One of the things I think is really interesting that Thailand's focused on, two key areas, and I'm taking information from you already, but I was so impressed by your decision. One was moving away from measuring arrivals, but measuring economic impact, which is so important. It is about job creation. It's about human capital development in lesser known destinations. And it's a win-win for all. And the other is the minister's efforts in community-based projects. I was here in July with a group of 50 destinations from around Asia Pacific, and we call it a digital boot camp. We make them work. But what we experienced, for those of you who have never done it, go and visit the Ama diving ladies. This is over 1,000 years old. These are ladies who dive not for tourism, but because that was their livelihood. These ladies in their 80s still do it. But interestingly, it's become a great tourism traveler experience. And I think those are the types of community projects we need to hear more about. We need to support those ladies in their efforts. I'm sure they're very familiar with the latest technology, but perhaps they need a hand. So how can we, as the prefecture in Mie or Ise City, how can we give them those tools? And on that note, I'm going to be short, sharp and sweet, hopefully, and hand over back to Anita. Thank you very much.
Excellent. Sarah, thank you very, very much. And it's lovely how you brought it back to feeling the heartbeat of the people that are tourism, that the tourists ultimately enjoy. We're now, going to go into theme number one, which is focusing on social inclusivity, on poverty alleviation. And so ultimately what we want to do is celebrate the countries that are doing it in a way that absolutely makes sure all the people are involved. What we found, however, though, is that part of sustainable tourism is recognizing that countries go through challenges, whether it's Mother Nature, as we've seen, it could be political change, it could be economic change. But ultimately, through tourism, we not just find incredible destinations, we find heroes. And our next speaker is a heroine who comes from a country that ultimately is a place where, as we say, it all begins. And ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome to the next 3 minutes, Dr. Arab Ragab, the Vice Minister of Tourism of the Arab Republic of Egypt. Madam.
Good morning. Good morning, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests. It is an honor to be here today in beautiful Tokyo, the twin city of Cairo, amongst this amazing group of tourism enthusiasts and promoters. By the way, how many people here believe that tourism is equal to optimism? I think all of us. You know why? Because tourism provides diverse employment opportunities at all ages and skill levels, improves the life of the local host communities, empowers youth and women, and contributes to the economy with foreign currencies. So it is a motivation for happiness and peace. The world now is focusing on development policies considering the environmental protection, resource efficiency, and cultural heritage preservation to strengthen and create sustainable tourism. I believe, in this regard, that our Egyptian candidate, Dr. Mushira Khattab, for UNESCO Director General, could be and would be reflecting Egypt's endeavor of enhancing linkages to the heritages and cultural assets, and unifying the world efforts addressing the cultural challenges. Moreover, the government of Egypt has launched the new sustainable development strategy called Egypt Vision 2030, addressing all sectors with a special emphasis on eco-friendly tourism projects to preserve environment for the next generations. Moreover, the Ministry of Tourism has identified areas of special environmental interest and protected them with law and regulations, such replacing at least 20% of traditional energy into renewable ones, and involve local communities as partners to reduce poverty and control immigration. Other programs also have been implemented to raise awareness and public ownership towards resource promoting recognition and knowledge for socio-cultural pride. Social media, through advanced marketing policies, is currently an ideal medium for the promotion of Egypt tourism. In addition, considering tourism as a driver for economic development, the private sector plays a role, a vital role, in collaboration with the Ministry of Tourism, the government, to contribute to more inclusive growth, to move up the value chain, and to promote cultural authenticity of destination. To conclude, there are lots of efforts that have been done. However, we are still facing some challenges where I believe that with your support and cooperation as investors and tourists, we will succeed to overcome them and to achieve all our targets. Thank you.
Shukran, madam. Thank you very much. As we all know, sustainable tourism for development is something that we take very seriously. It's something that has become part of our strategies, it's become a part of the DNA of how we operate. But there's one lovely Honourable Secretary of Tourism up here who I think can actually argue that they have a different twist on it in their country. Because as we know from the Honourable Secretary of Tourism of the Philippines, even when it comes to sustainability, it's more fun in the Philippines. Madam.
Thank you, Anita. I'll try to make it 3 minutes. The Philippines is concerned more than ever about inclusive and sustainable economic growth, as well as environmental protection and climate change, two themes that run parallel each other. Being an archipelago of more than 7,100 islands, the Philippines is vulnerable to the impact of climate change. The country's wide range of unique flora and fauna is constantly in danger. The country's tourism product portfolio is anchored on nature-based tourism, sun and beach tourism, cruise and nautical tourism, diving and marine sports tourism. Because of this, environmental protection becomes all the more critical and necessary. These resources, after all, are part and parcel of the country's attraction. Upon these beautiful backdrops, the Filipino people deliver a more fun experience for our tourists. Without measures to ensure environmental protection, we cannot ensure the sustainable growth of the tourism industry nor reap its economic benefit. For this reason, the Department of Tourism has undertaken various initiatives. The National Tourism Development Plan, NTDP, for 2017-2020 will serve as the country's blueprint for sustainable tourism. Our vision is to develop a globally competitive, environmentally sustainable, and socially responsible industry which promotes inclusion in growth through the generation of more jobs, which hopefully leads to a better distribution of income. This strategy aims to introduce more cultural offerings and promote environmental preservation, climate change adaptation, and implement risk crisis management program. In 2014, the Philippines hosted the UNWTO ASEAN International Conference on Tourism Climate Change. Senior tourism ministers and industry experts from 18 countries convened in Legazpi, Albay. The conference leaders adopted Legazpi's declaration on tourism response to climate change, which calls upon the UN, the government, and their attached agencies, NGOs, international bodies, and private sector to recognize and promote awareness of tourism's importance in development agenda and its growing contribution to socio-economic change. In the field of culinary tourism, the department has also played host to this year's Madrid Fusion Manila, an international gastronomy congress where the world's top chef shared fresh initiatives leading towards a sustainable gastronomic planet. Riding on 2017 International Year of Sustainable Development, the Philippines hosted the 6th UNWTO International Conference on Tourism Statistics last June 21 to 24, 2017, which focused on measuring sustainable tourism. Conference participants called on the development and implementation of a statistic framework for measuring sustainable tourism, which will impact economic, environmental, and social dimension. Through this initiative, the Philippine Department of Tourism hopes to join the worldwide effort to protect environment and ensure the sustainable of tourism industry. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much, madam. One of the challenges of sustainability is that it doesn't just apply to countries that are already strong destinations. It's an even greater focus of countries that have become leading destinations in terms of tourism interest. One of those beautiful destinations, as we all know, is Myanmar. which has opened to the world and has become very high on the list of places you must see for travelers. But how do you manage that growth? Exactly as Mr. Lowell has said, how do we make sure we don't become a victim of our own success? It is now my great pleasure to ask and to give 3 minutes to Mr. Un Wong, the Minister of Hotels and Tourism of Myanmar. Sir, the stage is yours.
Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. We say Minglawa in Myanmar. I would like to extend a warmest welcome to you all on behalf of the Government of the Republic of the Union of Myanmar and on my own behalf. It is my great honor and pleasure for me to have a chance to deliver some words at this very important and auspicious occasion of the first ever Tourism Ministerial Round Table meeting, which is a small table, during the Jeddah Tourism Expo 2017. It is a very exciting and a joyful moment for me to meet you all in this beautiful city, Tokyo. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, to keep pace with the fast-changing needs of visitors and challenges faced by the tourism industry, we are undertaking a structural planning process to map out our strategies, initiatives, and resources allocation for the coming years for tourism development. Our country, Myanmar, is extremely blessed with natural beauties and attraction for tourists, and it stands today as one of the very few countries that still exists as virgin land in this modern world. And I can also count on to say that we are the only country in Southeast Asia that have beautiful sceneries from the sea up to the snow-capped mountain in the north. Please do come and explore. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, let me brief you a few words about tourism status of Myanmar. Our tourism development is just at a take-off position. Due to the changes of Myanmar's political landscape, Myanmar has been gaining success in various aspects, and tourism is part of them. Moreover, we are developing our tourism in a responsible and sustainable way under the Myanmar Tourism Master Plan. To contribute and advance sustainable development in all pillars, such as economic, social, environmental, cultural, and peace, we are establishing tourism to be a powerful, transformative force by doing activities for tourism awareness and exploring community-based tourism, sites for local benefits and poverty reduction, enhancing human capacities and destination management. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, Myanmar warmly welcome tourists from all around the world, and of course also from Japan. We will continue to facilitate smooth and efficient access to the country. The Ministry of Hotels and Tourism, in collaboration and cooperation with related ministries, region and state governments, Myanmar Tourism Federation, is developing Myanmar as a year-round destination with geographically spread product base. In collaboration with JICA, we are currently implementing regional tourism development project in Bagan. I do appreciate and thanks to the Japan government for supporting this project. Hoping to attract more foreign investors, revised Myanmar foreign investment law had been enacted very recently. In conclusion, I would like to once again express my sincere appreciation and profound thanks to all, and I wish this ministerial meeting and related meetings in Jeddah Expo 2017 to contribute a better understanding of the challenges we face and yield practical recommendations. I do hope that your deliberations will lead to step forward to achieve the future goal, as the year 2017 has been designated the International Year of Sustainable Tourism for Development. Thank you.
Sir, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, I ask you now to join me as we travel from Myanmar all the way to Uzbekistan. And we hear from Mr. Abziz Abdukakimov, the chairman of State Tourism State Committee of Uzbekistan. Sir.
Thank you, Anita. Dear ministers, ambassadors, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you, our esteemed colleagues, organizers of this event, UNWTO, head of ministries, and express to all of you my great respect. Wish you productive and successful work during this forum. From ancient times, tourism united the people of our planet. People went on the trip to discover the new lands, the knowledge of the world, and establishment of cultural and diplomatic ties. The Central Asia region played an important role in this process due to its location at the crossroads of caravans, trade routes, cultures, and civilizations. The centers of formation and development here is of ancient statehood are Samarkand, Bukhara, Hiva, Shahrizabs, the same age as Rome and Babylon. They are widely known as the largest centers of medieval scenes, art, and culture, and included in the UNESCO World Heritage List. Thanks to tourism, we learn what tolerance is. The concept is international. It has no nationality. Tolerance, above all, means respectful attitude to each other, and most importantly, understanding each other. Therefore, I think you will agree with me if I say there is a tolerance where tourism is developed. Taking this opportunity, I would like to dwell the most important factors determining the development and effectiveness of international tourism. They are the problems of ensuring peace and security, political and economical stability in the world as a whole, in certain regions and each country where tourists are welcomed. Growth of incomes of population, its well-being. Development of the tourist infrastructure, the convenience of transport delivery, hotel services, and everything related to tourism logistics, the introduction of modern information technology, all that we meet at every step. Investment directed to tourism infrastructure, including both budgetary investment and creation by state of necessary privileges and preferences for private capital and business. Dear friends, we highly appreciate the developing fruitful relation with the World Tourism Organization and place great hopes on further strengthening of our cooperation, implementing of joint programs and projects. Firstly, we are talking about the significant improvement of the tourist image and increasing the potential of my country, Uzbekistan, in this area, enhancing its attractiveness primarily through the social networks, supporting the wide distribution of the brand, the Great Silk Road. We are always glad to see you in Uzbekistan, so that you can feel our warm hospitality. It gives me great enjoyment to express my sincere gratitude to all who's gathered in this stage, to wish fruitful work, health, prosperity, and new successes in your noble activity. And if you, I speak a little Japanese, and if allow me, I
would
say
love to hear that.
So, JATA no minasama.
So the representative of JATA, especially Chairman Yamaguchi and President Matsuyama, we're very happy to be involved with all of you and everybody who's engaged in tourism. From the bottom of my heart, I am very grateful. In many more areas, I'd like to see our cooperation progress and prosper. Thank you.
I must say, that was extremely impressive. Not just your speech, but the doing it in Japanese. Dare I ask, because I'm sure all of us are wondering, how did you learn such magnificent Japanese?
I studied in Japan for 2 years at Hitotsubashi University, but it was a long time ago, but I still remember some words in Japanese. Thank you.
It's beautiful. I must say, you've taken an excellent export out of Japan by taking the language with you. Ladies and gentlemen, our final speaker for themes 1 and 2, which focuses on social inclusivity, job creation, and on poverty alleviation, is a woman who has a great place in all of our hearts. And she is from the Kingdom of Thailand, and dare I say, she is Thailand's Queen of Tourism. Please, may I now hand the stage to Khun Kobkarn, please.
Thank you so much. Well, everyone has already answered everything. But I would like to add on that I think what is most important thing about tourism is about the people. The people with heart, the people who believe, the people with passion. Because at the end of the day, I believe that every government believes in tourism. Now the tourism minister start to sit on the front row. And that is the crucial point. When everyone would like to come to touch on tourism and believe that tourism is economic pillars. If we start measure tourism only with figures, tourism will become just a product. I have come from business sector. I remember the red ocean, when you only focus on the percentage and the increment, and at one point there will be about only profit and cost cutting. So this is a great time when we come and talk about sustainability, and that's why in Thailand we shift the target from that be the number, but how much we can help more people, which is very important, and we should not lose sight of this. And that is why I said tourism is about the people. But then again, when we talk about the people, I would like to add on that what is more important is the young generation. I believe we here understand what we are doing. But the young generation and the next generation, whether or not they really follow a path. I talked to the village, the successful CBT, community-based tourism. The young generation, they have better education. They go abroad and they return home and they feel that, why do I have to keep on wearing this huge tribe costume? Can I change? I want to grow with the world. So this is our task. Something that we are trying to tell them that this is your identity. This is our identity. Whether or not they believe in what we are offering or not, this is a challenge, a future challenge, or maybe the challenge that is happening now. So I think we are now going on the right path. But we need to start talking now and embrace the young generation, the future generation, how to make sure that tourism at the end of the day is not only just money making, but is the pride of being themselves. Thank you.
Having 17 very different definitions of the word sustainable, what it means for tourism, and dare I say that the lovely Honourable Minister of Tourism of Sport of Thailand has a metric that is unique. It's not about arrivals, it's not about revenues, it's not only about job creation and the opportunities that it's creating through capacity building, it's also heartbeats. Because she is one of the finest leaders when it comes to bringing us back to not just our profession of tourism, but the vocation that we are all very blessed to be a part of. And as she said, it's about making sure that we are protecting the future of tourism through our efforts, which is why we're going to shift into themes 3 and 4 now, which is about resource efficiency, which is about conservation. And our first speaker is going to be the lovely Chantatit, the Vice Minister of Tourism of the Kingdom of Cambodia. Sir.
Thank you, and good afternoon, Excellency, ladies and gentlemen. Before we go to the point of the experience or best practices in Cambodia, let me take this opportunity to share with you the best topic today of the sustainable tourism or sustainable development of tourism. I think regarding this sustainable tourism, it refers mainly on the impacts of tourism on the four main areas: the social, culture, environment, and economy. This is very important. If we want tourism developed in a sustainable manner, we need to keep maximizing of the positive impact of tourism, and at the same time, minimizing the negative impact or eliminating the negative impact on the four main areas. This is the core function of the tourism or the core function of sustainable development of tourism. There are many cases around the world, or we call lessons learned from around the world on the sustainable development of tourism, including Cambodia. As you aware that this country have passed through long history, difficult time, war, political problem, and now build the country back to the kingdom with the peaceful, stable, and tourism is one of the great sectors for socio-economic development of the country. Government of Cambodia recognized tourism is a tool for not only for the economic, but also for the fight poverty as well. And we use tourism as the, in Cambodia we call tourism as the green goal. It has another color of the goal to represent tourism support to the green development and also the response to the better environment in the country as well. Talking to the sustainability again, I think it's important as to encourage involvement of the stakeholder, start the beginning of development of this tourism. Stakeholders, the best practices that we use in Cambodia, we call 4P best practices from the public sector, private sector, partnership, and also from the people. And these people, including local community who provide services to tourism and also the tourists. Tourists have to be respond to the development of the destination. Another important in the process of development of the tourism, I think the tourism has two main effects, as we already discussed in this forum. Internally and externally, this is very important. We can manage it internally, but external impact or effect from outside is hard to manage, as the war, political problem, economic crisis, or even the natural disaster as well. So another important is the we need to allow the better flow of visitors to the destination to support the development, as so far we has very well in terms of the cooperation in around the region and in the world as well. So, but we still facing another challenges of the external factor on the flow of visitors from one country to another, from the one region to another. I think because of the some reason, political reason, economic reason or whatever, because of the skin, different skin, face, or hair, or even region, then have been restricted by some other country. I think we should use our platform as well. This the part of sustainability of the world tourism in the future to help support and to allow the better flow of visitor. And this is part we agree that the travel is a part of human right, a right of people to travel, a right of people to visit, to exchange and whatever. And this is support to development of tourism. So I think the final conclusion from my point of view, we need to put our further cooperation together, work in tourism, make tourism better world. As the Taleb Rifai mentioned, that the bill, better world of the living and visiting our people. And this is our vision, and also the toward to the vision, our vision 2030, the journey to 2030, that we expect to have 1.8 billion or beyond that of the people across the border and support to development. And I should stress that it's important is peace, security, and stability of the country or destination is very important. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. We now travel from Cambodia to France. Please may I ask Christian Mantei, the General Manager of Atout France, to speak.
Your Excellency. Your Excellencies, Ministers of Tourism, representatives of the tourism industry and major destinations, ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, when we think about developing sustainable tourism, we must think about the relation between tourism and the cultural values of our countries. Why do people engage in tourism? They want to enjoy experiences different from home and meet people different from themselves. If French people go to Japan, for example, and they do things they can also do in France, and meet Japanese people who are just like French people, they will be disappointed. They will not come to Japan again. They will not talk about Japan to their friends and families. And so, we are not developing a form of sustainable development in tourism. If French people come to Japan and the experiences they have here are not possible in France, and they meet Japanese people who display a different culture, then they will be satisfied. They will come to Japan again. They will talk about Japan, and we are succeeding at developing sustainable tourism. We are all very lucky because each country is different and as rich as specific cultural values. But just having diversity and local culture is not enough. First, we need to be able to make our culture and identities understandable and interesting to foreign visitors. This is in part the role of tourism development, including developing strong global brands based on local and authentic contents. Second, we need to make our populations understand that international tourism is not going to change their local cultures and lifestyles. Tourism can bring a lot of revenues to a destination, but if a destination must become something else to satisfy foreign visitors, local people will become frustrated. They will oppose more tourism development and business will decline. We must avoid this by using clever tourism management. Developing sustainable tourism is all about using our differences to develop tourism business while respecting local identities and cultures. If we can do this, then tourism is a fantastic chance for all of us to be proud of our cultures and to bring sustainable economic activities to our countries. Thank you.
Christian, merci beaucoup. And Christian's raised a really important point about the fact that part of being sustainable, especially when it comes to culture, is celebrating our languages and the differences of our language, which is why I ask you all please to grab your little translation packs if you don't have it, because our next speaker, a very, very dear friend from the community, she is going to speak en español. May I please introduce Marcela Basegalupo, the Minister of National Tourism Secretariat, the Republic of Paraguay. Madame.
Thank you very much. The organizers, everybody.
The view of sustainable tourism for development has awakened the commitment of Paraguay to guide and deepen the tourist activity, harmonizing cultural values, diversity and heritage, contributing to the sustainable development goals adopted by the United Nations. In this context, our work focuses on strengthening the Guarani Jesuit route, a tourist icon of our country that today constitutes a wonderful cultural, historical, and architectural experience, which in the land of national in the hands of the National Secretariat of Tourism is reaching a economic dynamics with empowerment of the population. It is our priority to make this route a generator of benefits for the communities, highlighting the tangible and intangible heritage of the cultural legacy of the Guarani and Jesuits. The Jesuit route of Paraguay, which runs through 8 villages in the south of the country, awakens in the tourist a set of sensations based on testimonies expressed in old buildings, in the varied local crafts, in the abundant green surroundings, the patrimony in the gastronomy based on ancestral recipes and the music performance by members of the Mubia Guaranina choir of the community of Guavirami in the mission of Trinidad. In the area of mutual understanding and tourism as a peace-building industry, we have been coordinating with other Mercosur countries with the support of the Inter-American Development Bank, the formation of the Ruta Jesuitica Multidestino, which aims to be a circuit that unites at least 30 towns of the Southern Cone, including 9 UNESCO Patrimony of the Humanity. All these efforts would lack a sustainable basis over time with without the active involvement of the communities as a whole. That is why the national government promotes public policies and politics that allow the empowerment of women and young people in the country's tourism development. One of the successful programs is Posadas Turisticas, through which hundreds of women have managed to turn their homes into business units, adapting accommodation spaces with typical elements of Paraguayan handicrafts. This program is present in at least a quarter of the total number of cities in this country, allowing tourists to extend their stay in 50 destinations, increasing tourist spending and allowing a better use of the culture that characterizes each community. Along the same line, we have been working with young people through a program called Turismo Joven, through which young leaders lead the tourist circuits in their communities. Through this initiative, we have trained 3,000 young people from the country, of whom 100 are already leading tourist proposals designed by themselves. Paraguay aspires to be a destination capable of attracting the attention of those tourists who are looking for responsible, supportive, inclusive, accessible, and experiential tourism. That is to say, a destiny that is committed to sustainable tourism. Thank you so much.
Muchas gracias, madam. Thank you very much. We now go into some of our final speakers as we go into our final minutes of the session itself. We have a gentleman in the room who has come all the way to Tokyo from down under, who is all the way across the stage, to whom I absolutely respectfully give the next 180 seconds. It's Mr. John O'Sullivan, the Managing Director of Tourism Australia. Sir.
Thank you. Ministers, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I would advise you all to keep your translation earpieces in, because I am going to speak Australian to you. We have a goal in Australia and a vision for our country, which is to make it the most desirable and memorable destination on the planet. And the key way that we do that through our marketing pillars is focusing on 3 key elements of the country, and they are our people, our products, and our places. And in this pillar of people, we talk about our Indigenous culture, Australia is very blessed for many things. We have amazing wildlife, a very beautiful country. But what we also have is the world's largest continuous Indigenous culture of some 70,000 years of Indigenous Australians. And in 2015, we made a conscious decision to focus on this particular part of our country and our marketing creative, irrespective if we were talking about Australia's food or its coastal and aquatic attractions. We made a strategic decision to include within Tourism Australia a recognition action plan, setting quotas for the numbers of Indigenous employees within our company. And very importantly, we've started now to work with some 70 Indigenous Australian tourism businesses and promote them to the rest of the world. And we believe that supports the third pillar of our campaign, which is about place. And we heard before about the importance of regional dispersal. And that for us is incredibly important because almost 50 cents of every dollar spent by an international visitor to our country is in regional parts of Australia. And as we like to say, people and places really do make a trip because you don't ask someone over to your house for dinner at night to show them a piece of furniture. Unless, of course, you're Sarah Matthews from TripAdvisor. But in addition to that, that was a sledge. In addition to that, we did some surveys within the Australian public, along with Tourism New Zealand, about people's reaction to international tourism as a fallout from that particular campaign. We found that 94% of Australians all wanted to see more international tourists coming to Australia and embrace the industry. Thank you.
Excellent. John, thank you very, very much. It is now my great pleasure to ask to speak for the next 180 seconds, Mr. Sergio Deus, the Tico Maravis, the advisor to the Minister of Economy of the Republic of Lithuania. Please, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, growing numbers of international tourists make sustainable tourism exceptionally relevant. Up to 70% of Western European tourists take into account the level of sustainable development in the country of the travel destination. They evaluate how ecological is its environment. They prefer services with certification. They are looking for authentic experience and contacts with local communities. And it's good news for us Lithuanians, as far as according to the surveys, cultural and historical heritage, diversity are the main reasons why foreign tourists choose Lithuania. Lithuania is divided into five ethnographic regions which determine strong national identity of the country. Each region has unique dialect, set of customs and traditions, specialities of cuisine. The regions are promoted as holders of materials and immaterials entities of UNESCO heritage with unique value of global level. They offer a wide range of cultural, historic, ethnic, natural, active and medical tourism products. However, last year tourism sector in Lithuania grew by 10% and accommodation establishments hosted 1.5 million foreign tourists. I would like to stress up that the population of Lithuania is only 3 million. However, the main flows of foreign tourists are concentrated in the larger cities of Lithuania, Vilnius, Kaunas, Klaipėda. And last year, more than half of foreign tourists stayed in our capital, Vilnius. The attraction of tourists to Lithuanian regions has many aspects of economic, ecological, social, and cultural sustainability. Therefore, the issue of sustainable tourism has to be disputed on national level. The program of Lithuanian government has defined the development of quality culture services as well as sustainable and competitive economical environment as their priorities. This year, the Ministry of Economy presented the guidelines for development of sustainable tourism in the Republic of Lithuania, which determined that the concrete measures for improvement of the situation, such as development of tourism infrastructure, improvement of the services of regional tourism information centers, ensurance of more active integration of ethnic culture in tourism services. The implementation of these measures shall have positive effect on the key indicators of local tourism. By active engagement in the World Tourism Organization, Lithuania ensures the development of tourism in its regional and solution for other issues of sustainable tourism in the country. This year, Lithuania was selected to the Executive Council of the WTO as a Vice Chairman of the European Commission and the representative of the Europe at the Committee of Sustainable Tourism. Lithuania has successfully worked on the implementation of said targets. And next week, the first Sustainable Tourism Awards will take place in Lithuanian capital Vilnius. We are meant to present and promote the initiatives of sustainable tourism, encourage their development, improve the image of Lithuania as a country of sustainable tourism development. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. And I must say, I'm very grateful to all of our speakers who have maintained their 180 seconds because we have a little bit more time and we have our final speaker. Now, another little secret to share with you all. In South Africa and in Africa per se, we all know that the lion is deemed to be the most powerful of animals. It's the male cat that goes around and is always seen to be doing the kill. But the women in Africa know it's actually the lionesses, because they're the ones that do the work. They're the ones that exhaust the prey that allow then the lion to go in and do the kill. When it comes to tourism in South Africa, we are very grateful to have our lioness. It is now, please, my time to welcome Ms. Thokozile Kasa, the Minister of Tourism of South Africa.
Thank you very much. Is it working? Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. May I take this opportunity to thank the UNWTO as well as the organizers of this very successful event. Together with everybody who is here, I think all of us very much appreciate the work that you are doing. We're coming from South Africa, and we just launched a campaign that tourism is everybody's business. We want everybody to appreciate the value of tourism and also participate, feel part of what is happening. South Africa boasts highly developed first world economic infrastructure. You remember we hosted the FIFA World Cup in 2010, and we are one of the emerging economies. And at the time of the economic meltdown globally, we embarked on a concerted effort to build infrastructure because we believed that it would attract investment into the country. And at the moment, it has made us to rally everybody across government, across all spheres of government, to ensure that we all work together. We, for instance, have a mechanism of an investment arm that we have, which has bankable projects across various sectors with incentives that come from government, where we are identifying that investment that comes into the country, we will be able to channel it so that it benefits our people. Tourism is one of the six key growth sectors, and it has been growing 3% annually. At the moment, contributes about 9% into the GDP. So we are happy with that. And we are happy that it has been given a focus by government. And therefore, it is one area where we think the UN Declaration of 2017 of Sustainable Tourism for Development works well for us, because it assists us to really come together to make sure that we develop tourism for inclusive growth. We are finalizing our National Tourism Sector Strategy for 10 years, and our pillars that talk to inclusive growth and sustainable tourism involve an approach where we are developing together a framework for maximizing empowerment of previously disadvantaged people. And we have concessions in government, especially in state-owned facilities. We are developing partnerships to bring in black operators, operators and managers for companies in state-owned companies, and also working with industry, we're scaling up enterprise and supplier development. And state procurement has been dictated to be 30% for women and young people. So we are developing products, we are giving skills to our young people, we're giving skills to women, we're looking into funding, and we also are exposing them to various markets. So we are running behind as government, and we have identified areas where we can unlock potential. One of those areas is marine and coastal tourism. All our government interventions are aimed at ensuring that those SMMEs would be the primary beneficiary. All big companies would partner in order to develop our communities. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Madam, and thank you for that final address from our 17 great speakers. We now have the ultimate time challenge coming up, because as we are clearly running short on time because of the richness of dialogue, it is my great pleasure to give the last 60 seconds. Now that's Japanese 60 seconds, not Spanish 60 seconds, sir, to Mr. Su Jing to do a quick summary of our session today, please.
Thank you, Anita. Between the lunch and my summary, I will choose to be brief. I would like to probably recall 3 points. Number one, as you would all agree with me, that it has been very heartening that we have had such a wide spectrum of international representation. It has been a truly global coverage of the presentations that you heard from both the national, the regional, and international perspective. And I must recognize and compliment the efforts made by all the ministers and the senior CEOs sitting around all these fine round tables. And number two, we would like to believe probably we have indeed chosen the right topic, the topic of sustainability, because it is not about linking our tourism sector with that philosophy of sustainability, but it is about how this industry can survive. It is the basic need for us to continue our operations along the line of sustainability as a principle, as something that we must continue to advocate. And lastly, I would like to use the Honorable Minister of Thailand's words that ministers of tourism, not only it is not enough that they need to sit in the front row of any cabinet meetings, it has to be in the center stage of any social and economic agenda of the world. And with that, I think it is very obvious that this forum, which has been very successful, needs to be continued not only for the next year, but for the next and next year. I thank you.